He cries when they sing it.
No, it's like when we stop singing, he smiles and we sing it.
All right, let's go ahead and open up to Joshua chapter 12. Joshua chapter 12. I want to read 6 verses from chapter 12 and 6 verses from 13. So we're in Joshua chapter 12. Let's start at verse 1 there. It says, "Now these are the kings of the land which the children of Israel smote and possessed their land. On the other side Jordan, toward the rising of the sun, from the river Arnon unto Mount Hermon, and all the plain on the east. Sihon, king of the Amorites, who dwelt in Heshbon, and ruled from Aroer, which is upon the bank of the river Arnon, and from the middle of the river, and from half Gilead, even unto the river Jabbok, which is the border of the children of Ammon. And from the plain to the sea of Chinneroth on the east, and unto the sea of the plain, even the salt sea on the east, the way to Beth Jeshimoth, and from the south under Ashdoth, Pisgah, I was trying to say Pigza, I don't know why. Verse 4, and the coast of Og, king of Bashan, which was of the remnant of the giants that dwelt at Ashdoth and Edrei, and reigned in Mount Hermon, in Salka, in all Bashan, under the border of the Geshurites, and the Maacathites, and half Gilead, the border of Sihon, king of Heshbon. Them did Moses, the servant of the Lord, and the children of Israel smite. And Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave it for a possession unto the Reubenites, and to the Gadites, and the half tribe of Manasseh." And let's turn to chapter 13. Start once again in verse 1. We're going to read 6 verses. "Now Joshua was old and stricken in years, and the Lord said unto him, Thou art old and stricken in years, and there remaineth yet very much land to be possessed. This is the land that yet remaineth, all the borders of the Philistines, and all Geshuri, from Sihor, which is before Egypt, unto the borders of Ekron, northward, which is counted to the Canaanite, 5 lords of the Philistines, the Gazathite, and the Ashdothite, and the Eshkelonite, the Gittite, and the Ekronites, also the Avites, from the," some people joke and they say the Millerites and the Budlites. Verse 4, "from the south, all the land of the Canaanites, and Mira, that is beside the Sidonians, unto Aphek, to the borders of the Amorites, and the land of the Giblites, in all Lebanon, toward the sunrise, and from Baal-Gad under Mount Hermon, unto the entering of Hamath." Verse 6, "all the inhabitants of the hill country from Lebanon, unto Misrephoth-Maim, and all the Sidonians, them will I drive out from before the children of Israel. Only divide thou it by lot unto the Israelites for an inheritance, as I have commanded thee." So I'm going to have a message right now called Possessing Our Possessions. I was thinking on the way over here you could call this Possessed Christians or something. But Joshua, he fought to possess the land of Canaan for about 30 years. And as chapter 13 identifies, now he's old. We're going to notice in chapter 12, it's a bit of a history lesson with past triumphs, talking about Moses in the first 6 verses there in chapter 12. A list of the land inherited to Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh. And then a list of cities westward of the Jordan, conquered by Joshua, showing us that there was a portion of even Israel that was not going to wait to inherit the promised land of Canaan. So spiritually, I guess you could just park it right there and say, you know what? That means some Christians, they're going to try to get their inheritance now, in the here and now, and not really wait for the inheritance in heaven. So they're going to, I heard Bruckman said, no crown without a cross. You know, if you're not going to bear your cross now, you're not going to get a crown up there. You'll have all your reward right here. So, and that's a perfect picture there of Israel doing the same thing. So it concludes with a list of all the 31 kings that were conquered and taken under Joshua's command. Then in chapter 13, we look at God's conversation with Joshua, telling him there's very much land to be possessed in verse 1. Now, that word possessed, we need to take special attention to that word because it's already been conquered. The land's already been conquered. It's not being possessed. So, and then he gives them a to-do list of conquered lands that have not yet been possessed, verse 2 through 12. Then the concluding verses of chapter 13 give a list of land that's been delegated to Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, verse 13 through 33. So as we read the Word of God here, we see a glaring truth and chapter 12 and 13, that there's a difference, like I said, between conquering and possessing. You know, I guess it's a difference between a battle and a war. You know, I mean, you might win a battle, but that doesn't mean you won the war. And with that in mind, there's a huge personal application to all of us. Do you possess your possessions that God has given you, or are they possessing you? As we'll notice in verse that 3 out of 12 tribes of Israel would stay on the wrong side of Jordan, not possessing the promise for themselves. So let's go ahead and open in prayer. God, just ask now that you open your word to us. Help me, God, to make it plain. Help me, God, not to get in your way. And I just pray, Lord, I mean, even just in a small number of people that we are tonight, God, there's more problems than I could ever attempt to solve, you know, and there's questions that need answers, Lord, and, you know, we're all seeking your face, God. So just ask that you'd show up, please, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So my first point I want to look at is the past instead of the promised land. In verse chapter 12, verse 1 through 6, we already looked at it. It says, now these are the kings of the land which the children of Israel smote and possessed. See that? And then pretty much there's no doubt that we're going to lean on the everlasting harms of yesterday's victory to deliver them from present-day responsibilities that are out there. See, when they conquered those lands on the wrong side of Jordan, they were like, man, this place is just so great. You know, they're like, hey, you know, how about we just stay here? You know, and Joshua's like, well, you're still going to go fight with us on the other side of the Jordan. You can come back here if you want, but we're going over there, and you are too. And if they were like, oh, well, we like it here, I mean, probably just would have fought them or something. I don't know, or God would open up the ground on them. But they said, okay, okay. But think about that, crossing the Jordan, doing all that, so you're seeing all that victory, all God moving over there, just to say, oh, that was fun. All right, we're just going right back where we came from, back across Jordan. I bet God didn't open it up for him like he did on the way over. You know, and it's kind of a shame to think about that. You know, and I mean, I think as you're living in your Christian life, God's going to show you some victories that, you know, it'd just be a shame if later on you just turned your back. Just be a shame, you know, that, you know, to think that even a young guy like Luke, I mean, that you might have been used to reach that old man, you know, that the grandmaster guy, you know, I mean, you know, I mean, he's probably thinking like, what's up with this guy? He's got the twinkling in the eyes. I just don't get it, you know, and he seems happy and, you know, he's smart. And I mean, you might have sent him home that night really thinking, you know, and just a young guy. But you know, it would be a shame. Later on, you run into him, and you're like, hey, yeah, I used to be one of your students. He's like, what happened to you? You know, it's like you gotta hold that stuff high, man. And not high like prideful, but just protect it. You know, it's your testimony. See, I mean, Joshua, he was fighting for so long. Don't you think that he could have quit any day after he crossed the Jordan River? I mean, think about how miraculous that was. I think sometimes in my mind, when I go through something great like that, I'm like, now I can rest. But not with Joshua. That was just the beginning. And, you know, don't think that even Joshua wasn't tempted to quit time and time and time again, but he kept going and he kept fighting. And the temptation's always going to be to quit, but you got to fight the urge to settle for second best. You know, I guess you got three young people, that goes in marriage too. You know, you could always settle for second best. Well, he says he's a Christian, or she says she's a Christian, you know? And really it's just like, you're not too persuaded, you're settling. You know, you don't want to settle. You'll pay for that for the rest of your life, even if it doesn't work out, you know? So Reuben and Gad and the half-tribe of Manasseh, they were possessed with the past. So they were possessed with a poorer inheritance. Look at Numbers 32, we're gonna read 1-5. Numbers 32, 1-5. In Numbers 32, 1-5, it says, "Now the children of Reuben and the children of Gad had a very great multitude of cattle, and when they saw the land of Jazer and the land of Gilead, that behold, the place was a place for cattle, the children of Gad and the children of Reuben came and spake unto Moses," this is what we're talking about, this is before they ever crossed, "and to Eleazar the priest, and unto the princes of the congregation, saying, Adaroth, and Dibon, and Jazer, and Nimrah, and Heshbon, and Eliah, and Shebam, and Nebo, and Beon, even the country which the Lord smote before the congregation of Israel, is a land for cattle, and thy servants have cattle." Perfect fit! "Wherefore," said they, "if we have found grace in thy sight, let this land be given unto thy servants for a possession, and bring us not over Jordan." It's like a lot of Christians. You know, they don't want to go the whole way. They just want to go part of the way. And you know, there's a cost. There's a cost to that. You know, and it's not just you're going to get a break. I mean, you're still sitting in enemy territory. You know, the thing about Israel and the Promised Land and all that, they have natural barriers. You know, like natural borders, like the Golan Heights is one of them. It's this huge mountain that literally is like almost straight up. And it's a natural border from three of their enemies. Also, me and Mary Chris, we were able to visit like the Dead Sea. That's a natural border or barrier to Jordan. But the Dead Sea is like depleting. They're using it for so much stuff. It's literally going lower and lower and lower, and that natural barrier is soon going to be gone, and there's not going to be anything with it. But the Jordan, in this aspect, this would have been a natural barrier of protection from those things in the past, you know. And settling down possess them, you know. That's when your needs and your wants dictate everything. You know, I'm hungry. Okay, well, it's not time to eat yet. No, I'm hungry. Okay, well, I guess, you're just going to eat just whenever you feel like it? Yes, because I'm hungry. Okay, well, I'm sad. Oh, okay, well, I mean, you know, you got food, you got clothes, you got a house, you got a job, you got a loving family, you're saved. You know, I mean, but yes, but I'm sad. It's like, okay. I mean, your feelings and all that stuff is all just, you can't let those things dictate you, but in this sad fact, Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh, they were possessed with that. Now they're looking at the creation over the creator, okay? We've talked about it. I mean, they're literally like worshiping their cattle. They're like, this place is for cattle, and we have cattle. They haven't even seen the other side of Jordan. You don't think there's no place for a cattle over there? You know, and riches over the Redeemer. Now, I want to show you a few verses. Actually, if I can have a few people get one. Brother Tim, if you can get Proverbs 23:5. Luke, you get Ecclesiastes 10:19. And I need the names one more time.
Bonnie, Charlotte, and Corinne.
Charlotte, Corinne. Okay. Ms. Corinne, would you mind, or Mrs. Corinne, would you mind giving me Ecclesiastes 5:15, please?
Yes, sir.
Wait.
On Charlotte.
Okay. Yes, please.
Proverbs 23, verse 5. Wilt thou set thine eyes upon that which is not? For riches certainly make themselves wings, and they fly away as an eagle toward heaven.
And then Ecclesiastes 10:19? You're 5:15.
Okay.
And Luke's 10:19.
A feast is made for laughter, and wine maketh merry, but money answereth all things.
That's the old saying, money talks.
Yeah.
Okay. And then Ecclesiastes 5:15.
I considered all the living which walked under the sun with the second... As he came forth out of his mother's womb, naked shall he return to go as he came, and shall take nothing of his labor which he may carry away in his hand.
Right, so you can't take it with you. So they were so concerned with the here and now that they weren't even thinking about what was in the promised land. And a lot of Christians, they're like that also, where they would rather please men rather than please God. They don't want to have any enemies here. You know, and unfortunately, you can't think like that. You know, you got to be like, you got to please God first. You know, a verse, you know, that really I've used in my life is, when a man's ways please the Lord, he'll make even his enemies to be at peace with him. And it's like, I need that verse because I got me some enemies, you know. So I just figure, hey, I'll just serve the Lord in the meantime, and he'll sort it all out, you know. So these guys, they were too concerned with the here and now. So they're also promised to periodically enter the promise. Look at Numbers 32. Numbers 32. So this is when they get down to it. Like, oh, so you want to stay here, huh? Numbers 32. And we're going to start in verse 16. And it says, they came near unto him and said, we will build sheepfolds here for our cattle and our cities for our little ones, but we ourselves will go a ready arm before the children of Israel until we have brought them unto their place. And our little ones shall dwell in the fenced cities because of the inhabitants of the land. We will not return unto our houses until the children of Israel have inherited every man his inheritance. For we will not inherit with them on yonder side Jordan, or forward, because our inheritance has fallen to us on this side Jordan eastward. And we're going to 25. And Moses said unto them, if ye will do this thing, if ye will go armed before the Lord to war, and will go all of you armed over Jordan before the Lord until he hath driven out the enemies from before him, and the land be subdued before the Lord, then afterward ye shall return and be guiltless before the Lord and before Israel, and this land shall be your possession before the Lord. But if you will not do so, behold, ye have sinned against the Lord, and be sure your sin will find you out. And build your cities for your little ones, and folds for your sheep, and do that which hath proceeded out of your mouth. And the children of Gad and the children of Reuben spake unto Moses, saying, thy servants will do as my Lord commanded. So that's where that famous phrase, be sure your sin will find you out. That's where that comes from. I think I'm going to make a shirt with that. But, you know, it's true. It's true. So they were possessed with leaving the promised land. Psalm 84:10 says, for a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. You know, and you think about that. It's you're going to go into the promised land just to turn around and leave. But not only that, you're going to ditch your wives and your kids on the other side of Jordan, and you're going to leave them alone, go war, and then come back and hope they're okay. It's just not very smart. It's just not smart. So Joshua's past faces the present. So God has the kindness to tell Joshua he is old and his work on earth has not been completed. We're in chapter 13 and verse 1. Now Joshua was old and stricken in years, and the Lord said unto him, Thou art old. Joshua's like, oh, I didn't know that. And stricken in years. He's like, you're not even looking too good, man. You're old and ugly. And there remaineth yet very much land to be possessed. So, so God's kindness to tell Joshua is old and his work on earth has not yet been completed. You know, my question is, would God say that to you? You know, do you want to get into your old age and God be like, man, I had so much more for you, you know, in this life, you know, but unfortunately, you just weren't really willing to do it, you know, and look at you, you're already old. But Joshua, he possessed 100 years, which now have passed. And in 100 years, you'd think that there's not too much more to learn in 100 years. But yet Joshua had a lot more to learn, right? He didn't even possess all the possessions he was supposed to. And so there was much more to possess. So Joshua was told by God what? The truth. You know, you think about Joshua's life. You're telling me that man wasn't faithful to God? And God's like, hey man, you're old. So much more you were supposed to be doing, but man, you're so old. You're not going to be able to do it. I mean, Joshua's like, haven't I been faithful to you, God? Be nice, man. But you know what God told him? It's just the truth. It's just no feelings about it. It's just the truth. There was a lot of land that God wanted to give them, and they conquered it, but they didn't go in and possess it. They didn't, you know, get all the giants out of the land. They didn't get all the enemies out of the land. And they, after a while, you just get sick of fighting. You know, and well, I guess probably in your arena, you just get winded. And I mean, you get winded. And then it's just like, I've seen some fights where the guys are literally, they could just barely even like lift up their arms. And it's just, they've been fighting for so long, they're just tired. And, but I wanted to kind of take a rabbit trail on that topic where God just merely told him the truth. And look at 2 Timothy 4:2. 2 Timothy 4:2. Now, a lot of preachers, they get kicked for just merely telling the truth. Okay? And I'm sure you guys are familiar with the verse. It says, preach the word, be instant, in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. So I want to look at those three things, reprove, rebuke, and exhort. So a reproof is to what? To convict somebody. And so he lists out every land not yet inhabited by the people of Israel. In chapter 13, he's like, you know what, you could have done this, could have done this, could have done this. I mean, it's like, okay, I realize it. No, I'm not done. You could have done this, you could have done this. Wait, I get it, I know, I didn't do everything. Wait, I'm not done, could have done this. And Joshua's like, oh, wow. So what's God doing? He's reproving him. So as you look at your life, if God was to pull the plug today and you evaluate your life, would he say you have had too much time and have still not possessed the land? You know, would he say, you know what? I've given you nothing but time. You know, I've given you the right Bible, and you know it's the right Bible, and you got it. You know, and you go to church that has the right Bible, and they know it's the right Bible, and you got it. And now there's all these things I want you to do. I mean, if he just pulled the plug and said, time's up. Oh, but I wanted to do so much more for you, Lord. Too late. It's over. You didn't possess the land. You know, and I think a lot of Christians, they think that they're the only ones that could do that job. That's what I presume, just by the attitudes I see in a lot of Christians. But, you know, it's very easy for God to just say, next, and he'll just get somebody else to do it. You know, it's a shame to me to see a lot of charismatics, Pentecostals, are the main street preachers in California. Where are the Bible-believing Baptists, you know? Now, some people are like, oh, don't say Baptist. I use Baptist because I believe that's what the Bible teaches anyway. But I understand the Trail of Blood, the Baptist Church, Anabaptists, Huguenots, I mean, Waldenses, all those groups always existed outside of the Catholic Church. That's why we're Baptists here, because we're not part of the Catholic Church, you know. But some people are like, oh, don't say Baptist. It's like, whatever, you know. But what are you doing with your life? Think about that. If God just pulled the plug and you just appeared, you're like, whoa. Where am I? God's like, yeah, time's up. What do you mean time's up? I was young. Or Tim's case, I had a family. I mean, I was raising kids. Or, I mean, Luke's like, hey, man, you know, I didn't even get my black belt yet. You know, God's like, yeah, time's up. Sorry. You didn't possess the land. Or did you? Or like, no, you did great, man. In all those years, man, you were faithful. You know, I just figured you might as well just come up here and live with me. Right? I mean, it's either going to be one or the other. But I think if we're sober-minded enough, I think we can all say there's much more land I could be possessing. You know, there's many Bible verses that I should have memorized by now. You know, I should have had whole books memorized by now. And you know what? I mean, did I really try to get the people on my street saved or my family saved or, you know, did I even try at all? You know, and how we have our church set up here, it's partly because I'm wicked. You're like, what do you mean? I have to put the street preaching on the schedule because I need to force myself to go. You know, and I need to put the track table out there because my flesh is just going to be like, oh, I don't have time. And I'm just going to let AV go to hell. You know, but I can't. So I put that stuff on there. We could go more, but I just put that on there at least for the schedule. You know, so at least it gives the people that come here an opportunity, and it makes me go, because I need to go. You know, and so we looked at the reproof. So that's the conviction. So, and then there was the rebuke, which means to correct somebody. And in 13:1, Joshua 13:1, they are old and stricken in years, and there remaineth yet very much land to be possessed. He corrected them. So much land to be possessed. You know, you're not there yet, Joshua. And would you force God to give you a list of areas in your life that were lacking, like holiness, righteousness, and goodness? You think about areas like work. Are you lacking in work? What about school? Are you behind? Are you doing all you can do? I mean, what about in your home life? You know, if God just walked into your home, is he going to see that something's lacking there? What about in your marriage or even in your church? If God walked into this church, you know, is something lacking here? Or your music collection or something? What's not here that should be here? So there's a reprove, rebuke, and then an exhortation. And that's in chapter 13 and verse 6. And it says, all the inhabitants of the hill country from Lebanon unto Misrephoth-maim and all the Sidonians, them will I drive out from before the children of Israel, only divide it by lot unto the Israelites for an inheritance, as I have commanded thee. So all the inhabitants of that hill country, God was saying, I'm going to drive them out. So he slammed him, he reproved him, he rebuked him, and Joshua's sitting there spinning, and then he's like, but I'm going to get these guys out for you. Joshua's like, really? After, I mean, I didn't even possess all this land you wanted me to. But just like Joshua is faced with the uncomfortable fact that he had not possessed the land, God said, you know what, in spite of you, I'm going to do it. That's nice, isn't it? When it's just like, God, you know, I haven't been as faithful as I should have been, but you know what, your mercy and your grace, you know, got me this far, and it's going to give me the rest of the way home, like the Amazing Grace song. If Joshua would follow the Bible way, and God will do the same for you, so if you follow the Bible way, you know, he's going to get those inhabitants out of the land for you. But you need, now, I call it kind of an unlikely recipe, because in my mind, it's like, you're telling me if I read my Bible, if I pray, if I go to a Bible-believing church, and just try to tell some people along the way what Jesus did for me, you're going to do all this for me? God's like, well, yeah. Now, you think, even with psychological problems, you think like, well, I have depression, okay, for instance. How would going to church help my depression? It's like, so you talk to a psychologist, they're like, no. We need to go back and talk about the past or work through and deal and cope and hug. And God's like, no, just read my word, pray, go to a Bible believing and preach in church and share the truth with others. That's going to cure your depression? Huh? It's like going around the back door to cure the depression. You wouldn't think it has anything to do with it. Or, you know, you have marital problems. Oh, okay. You have marital problems. So you're telling me if I read my Bible, if I pray, if I go to a Bible believing and preach in church and tell some other people along the way what the Lord's done for me, it's going to fix my marriage. Yes. Yeah, that's what I'm telling you. I can tell you firsthand, like, we kind of had a rocky start, but we're human, amen? But, I mean, the counseling that we got just sitting in church services, where maybe walking into service, we're like, not even holding hands. And then after service, what? We're holding hands, walking to the car, just from going to a service. You understand, people pay thousands of dollars for that. And I got it for free. Wow, that's amazing. And it doesn't make sense. And I think that's why God did it like that. Because God says, look, for the preacher, I'm going to give you three things. It's a recipe. You're not going to understand it. But I'm going to give you three things that your preaching needs to have. Rebuke, reprove, and exhort. Oh, but the people are hurting. Uh-huh. Rebuke, reprove, and exhort. Oh, well, I mean, they're not even convicted about, you know, whatever. I want them to be rebuke, reprove, and exhort. Like, you see what I'm saying? It's like God gives you these recipes, and they make no sense to you. And he's like, just do that. And you're like, but it doesn't make sense. He's like, I know. But do it and watch. You know, now you think about in the worldly side, when people are going to some witch or something, they're like, hey, I got this issue going. And she gives like a crowfoot, a sagebrush. I mean, she's giving all this stuff. And she's like, yes, put it in boiling water and, you know, and stir it around and say these words that you don't understand. And people are like, okay. But then when it comes to God saying, reprove, rebuke, and exhort, we're not willing to do that. Isn't that odd? It's like when people become Christian or people become Bible believers, they like lose their brains. I mean, I don't know. I'm sure you guys have heard of some odd home remedies or something, like baking soda works for everything or something, or just drink this Bragg's apple cider vinegar or something. Yeah, I mean, there's these weird things that just work. Why can't God do the same thing? You know, and the fact is, he does do the same thing. He doesn't expect you to understand why he's telling you to do what he's doing. You know, he's saying, I want you to cross Jordan. Well, this is good for my cattle here. I know, I want you to cross Jordan. So think about these guys. After they ditch their family, then they cross Jordan, they're like, you know, they're fighting, right? They're looking around, they're like, this place was pretty good for cattle. And Moses is like, yeah, too late. Or Joshua, actually, if it's on the other side. Joshua's like, yeah, you know the deal, man. You're already going back. I settled. You know, Paul, the best Christian, he never possessed perfection. Look in Philippians 3:12. You know, don't want you to get too down. You know, think about Paul. He's the best Christian. Philippians 3:12. And he says, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which I am also apprehended of Christ Jesus. So Paul, he was still sinful. You realize that? You know, a lot of preachers, a lot of famous guys, they're teaching something called sinless perfection. And what are they teaching? They're teaching that if you're a Christian, you're just not going to be sinning anymore. And I just can't help but think of Romans 7. Let's go to Romans 7 and verse 18. Now, if you're a student of the Bible, you understand why they're trying to say that. Because there's verses in the Bible that teach a work salvation. And they're trying to reconcile it without dispensations. That's what they're trying to do. So they're like, oh, you just can't sin anymore. Oh, easy. Wait, easy? I'm in my flesh, the three enemies of God, the world, the flesh, and the devil, and I'm wrapped in one? This thing's wicked. So we're in Romans 7, and what did I say, 18? 18. And it says, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but to how to perform that which is good, I find none. So, I mean, he's even saying, where is it again? Oh, yeah, like verse 15. For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that I do. It sounded like Paul had a sin problem. It sounded like a habitual sin problem. That's what they try to do to you, too. Well, I sin, but I don't sin habitually. You know what my question is? Do you sin every day? Yeah, that sounds like a habitual problem. Are they going to be stupid enough to say, well, no, I don't sin every day? You just lied. You know?
Right.
Well, the best Christian ever, he never possessed perfection. Look at 2 Timothy 4:20. 2 Timothy 4:20. You think of the beginning of Paul's ministry, he was actually able to heal people. Now he's toward the end. 2 Timothy 4:20 says, Erastus abode at Corinth, but Trophimus have I left at Miletum sick. You know what? This guy was like the shining star of the apostles. And all of a sudden, he's got to leave his buddies sick? What happened? He never possessed perfection. See, Paul could also not heal Timothy of one of his often infirmities. So he recommends something similar to NyQuil, not wild turkey. You know? Look at 1 Timothy 5:23. Let me correct what I just said, because I said similar to NyQuil, not wild turkey. I'm going to say similar to grape juice, not wild turkey. So, what does it say? Luke, can you read that for me? 1 Timothy 5:23.
Drink no longer water, but use a little wine for thy stomach's sake, and thine often infirmities.
So, nurses, doctors, if you go in with a stomach issue, you know the last thing they're going to ask you to take for medicine?
Wild turkey.
Alcohol of any type. Alcohol is called, I'm learning these phrases from my nursing lady over there. It's called a GI irritant, so gastrointestinal irritant. So if you have a stomach problem, the last thing you want to take is any type of alcohol. Grape juice, on the other hand, has a lot of antioxidants. And we understand, we talked about a little bit last week, the new wine, the old wine. That's why the Bible says, a little wine for thy stomach's sake. You understand people get drunk using that verse? You're making Jesus a sinner. I mean, John chapter 2, oh, he made water into wine. I hear drunkards tell me that. He made water into wine. Yeah, and he got drunk, and he got everyone else drunk, right? Whoa. You see, they even realized when he put it like that, they're like, I couldn't really picture Jesus drunk. You know, and it's for good reason. See, not cirrhosis of the liver, alcohol poisoning, or something that would give the same effects as heroin when you quit. That's what alcohol does. You know, I took a homeless guy to the a rehab in Little Rock. I came back 3 days later. He was a hardcore alcoholic. His hands were literally like this. And I was like, what's the matter with you? What's going on? He's like, no, this is just, I haven't drank in 3 days. I'm like, I've never seen that. He said, getting off alcohol has the same effects as heroin. And I researched it, and it does. But yet you could buy it over, you know, oh, you could buy it right there.
How about that?
Little gas station. Oh, it's okay. You could get it over the counter. You know, you just got to be 21. Why aren't they selling heroin like that? Oh, heroin. Too bad. It's the same thing. More people die from alcohol-related anything than heroin-related anything. Oh, well, heroin's a killer. You're not looking at the facts. You know, Michelle Obama, she's attacking sugar. How many people per year does sugar kill opposed to how many people per year does alcohol-related deaths? You see? She looked like she needed to get off the sugar to me. But anyway, Joshua, I want to look at his past promise, and we're not going to be here too much longer. Go to Joshua chapter 1. Joshua judges Ruth. Always got to remember who judges Ruth. It's Joshua. In Joshua chapter 1, verse 5 and 6. This is God making his promise to Joshua. It says, there shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee nor forsake thee. Be strong and of good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. So there was a promise of God's protection. And then there is also a promise of God's blessing. Look at verse 7. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. Works, right? If you're looking for that in the Old Testament, you just found it there in verse 7. Without the works, God would not be blessing Joshua. In a Christian's life, it's not a salvation topic, it's a relationship topic. Okay, so we're saved not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but by his mercy he saved us. You know, not by works, I say amen, Shabbos, Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. But you know what? Without those works, your relationship with God's going to be hurting. What do you mean? You're not going to feel his presence like you used to. You know, and when you pray, it's going to feel kind of quiet because God wants to see you do something. It's just like a relationship with your dad here. He's a good dad. He loves you. You know, you got his last name. All that's set in stone. I mean, people try to change their name, but somewhere along the line, they have that name. And even if you did change your name, his blood runs in your veins. They could prove it in court. They could just draw your blood and prove it that you're related. They do it on Jerry Springer all the time. They really do. They're like, I don't know who the father is. And they take what? A blood test. So, but you know what? If you're not going to hang out with your dad, you're not going to talk to him, you're not going to say I love you, you know, or things like that, guess what? Your relationship with your dad's going to be kind of hurting. You know? And maybe when, I don't know, I don't really know what you guys are into or something, I would think Luke is into like flying drones or something. Am I right? Am I pretty close?
Yeah,
okay. That was a guess. But you know, I mean, don't think he's going to be buying you one, you know, if you're not talking to him or hanging out or doing what's expected. And it's the same thing with God. You bear his name. You're born again. If you put your faith in the death, burial, and the resurrection, you're born again. You're saved. You're a bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh, but if you're not hanging out with him, don't expect too much. He wants you to come to the dinner table when it's dinner time. If you're not showing up, you know? Well, then there was a promise of God's word in verse 8, Joshua 1, verse 8. The book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. So, it was the promise of God's protection, promise of God's blessing in verse 7, promise of God's word in verse 8. You know, isn't that nice that you have God's word? That you know what he said? You know, a lot of people, they don't know what he said. You know, and a lot of pastors are fighting against people ever knowing what God said. Well, the Septuagint says this. Or, well, you know, in the Greek, it says it more like this. And it's just like, you know what? You don't know Greek. Quit lying. Well, and then verse 9. It was the promise of God himself. Have I not commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest. Man, that's the best promise right there. That's the best promise. You know, even if he didn't give all the rest, God, if you just be with me in this life, what a miracle, isn't it? You know, that you're telling me that I could be locked up in a prison or in a dungeon like 50 feet deep and I won't be alone. Mary Chris is like, I don't want you to go preach out there alone. I'm like, I'm never alone. She's like, but you know what I mean. You know? But isn't that really something? You're never alone. You're never alone. I mean, even when you think you're alone, you're not alone. Yeah. You know, there's always someone watching you. Whose name is jealous, right? But let's go ahead. I think we could park it there because I have 2.5 more pages, but I think I could just park it there. All right? Anybody got a bloody nose from the heat in here? All right, let's, Brother Luke, you want to close in prayer, please?
God, thank you for the service we have here, that we have Christians that come together and fellowship and thank worship you, Lord. I pray you help everyone to take what's right from this sermon for them and apply it as intended. I pray you continue to help Brother Randy and his wife with their kid. I pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen. I think I got one more song. Let's do... He is able to deliver thee, number 260.